Hey corn growers, I'm Eric Wilson, agronomy manager for Wyffels Hybrids, coming to you today with another installment in our Fertility 101 series at Wyffels, sulfur and zinc fertility in corn. So, three topics I want to cover today, boil this down kind of simply for you. Why are sulfur and zinc important and what's their function in the plant? Deficiency symptoms of sulfur and zinc in corn. And what are the types of fertilizer that I can use and when should I be applying those? So first off, I want to spend some time talking about sulfur. A lot of times it gets referred to as the fourth major macronutrient, just in terms of how much a corn crop actually uses compared to the other three before it. So primary functions of sulfur, it's the big one in formation of chlorophyll. That's what makes photosynthesis work. Absolutely important to not only just corn, but all plants. Also, protein production along with nitrogen. Some secondary functions would be oil synthesis and enzyme activation. So, sulfur within the plant is actually an immobile nutrient, meaning it moves primarily with the transport of water. Some other facts about sulfur in corn. Corn requires on a per acre basis about 24 pounds plus or minus of actual sulfur on a per acre basis year over year. That's typically supplied by soil organic matter. So as you could surmise, if you have more soil organic matter, in theory, you have more potential to mineralize more sulfur on that particular acre. Opposite would be true if you're farming on a lower organic matter farm. In general, we need to assume that pretty much every year we need to apply some amount of supplemental sulfur to that corn acre. And that becomes especially important if we're in continuous corn situations. So sulfur deficiency symptoms can be pretty easily defined as interveinal chlorosis, and typically you'll see that on the upper newer growth of those leaves. So I mentioned earlier that sulfur is immobile in that plant. The only way it moves up to these newer leaves is if those leaves are actively growing and actively transpiring moisture. So when we have cool conditions early that can slow down overall plant growth, a lot of times that's when you'll see some of these sulfur deficiencies early season. It's actually thought that those streaks are possibly a result of inhibited chlorophyll production, which would give it its green color, thus coming through as kind of that bleached appearance or that interveinal chlorosis. So let's talk about when to apply sulfur. So I've got the sulfur uptake curve for corn over here on my left. Season-long availability of sulfur is absolutely critical. As you can see, when we get about pre-tassel or VTR1, we've achieved about 50% of total uptake of sulfur. So we still need to make sure that later in that season, we have availability of sulfur for that corn crop to take up and use into grain fill. As with nitrogen, sulfur is subject to leaching. So it has a negative charge. That's how it wants to exist in the soil environment. So if we get heavy rainfall or those conditions where we can leach nitrogen, we can also leach sulfur. So keep that in mind when you're trying to manage sulfur on your corn acres. Lots of different options on fertilizer for how you want to apply sulfur. Elemental is probably my go-to. That tends to be the cheaper form. Keep in mind when you apply elemental sulfur, not all of that is going to be available that first year. A lot of times guys that use elemental, they'll apply every acre every year so that there is always some available for that corn or possibly bean crop if that's the rotation they're in. Zinc sulfate is another good dry formulation of sulfur. And then we can get into other formulations such as potassium thiosulfate, ammonium thiosulfate, and ammonium monosulfate. So all of those are usable forms, for the most part, readily usable forms of sulfur, good ways to get sulfur on that crop. Application rates tend to range from about 15 to 20 pounds of actual sulfur per acre. And then do keep in mind that most soils here in the Midwest do provide some amount of sulfur from that soil organic matter. So we don't necessarily have to supply that whole 24 pounds, but especially in those corn on corn situations, we wanna make sure we're getting a little bit of supplemental sulfur on those acres. Next nutrient I said we'd talk about today is zinc. So zinc is a micronutrient that would just be defined by we use much less of that compared to other things like nitrogen and sulfur. comparably. Primary functions of zinc is enzyme activation. It's also used in chlorophyll and carbohydrate formation within corn plants. Secondary function would be has some regulation in hormone production. So technically this nutrient is plant mobile, however it doesn't move very easily within that plant. What I mean by mobile is it can move up and down in the xylem and phloem. Corn requires much less zinc compared to sulfur for sure. So a typical corn crop only requires about 8 ounces of actual zinc per acre. So you can see much less than the 24 pounds of sulfur that we were talking about before. It is, again, typically supplied by the organic matter in those soils. And if we are making zinc applications, they absolutely need to be based off of soil test results that we would have collected on that field. So typical zinc deficiency symptoms, they're kind of similar to sulfur deficiency symptoms, but a little more pronounced. You'll see that the bleaching or those bands shows up much wider. And again, we'll typically see this on those newer leaves. It is mobile within the plant, but it will typically show up on those younger, newer leaves first because they're the ones that are actively growing. So again, associated with those cool conditions early in the growing season, where growth can be slowed down, mineralization of zinc from that organic matter can be inhibited. We can run into some deficiency symptoms when we have high pH soil. So soil pH greater than 7, we can get some tie-up issues of zinc. And again, kind of like sulfur, this bleaching is thought to be the result of inhibited chlorophyll production in that new actively developing leaf. So when to apply zinc, this curve does look very similar to sulfur. And in fact, at about pre-tassel or just before VT, we have 50% of uptake of total zinc for that acre for that year. So it's important that we have season-long availability of zinc. However, unlike sulfur, zinc doesn't leach. If we have good supply of zinc in our soil, we can expect it to be there year over year. Not something that I would say we usually don't have to manage it every year like we do sulfur. So check those soil tests for that zinc level. That's what we're gonna make our application rates based off of. When we're making our zinc applications to make sure we get enough, first thing we wanna do is we wanna check that soil test because we don't wanna just go put extra zinc out there just for the sake of putting it out. We've got 3 really good sources of zinc fertilizer over here on the left. Again, those application rates are absolutely going to vary based on that soil test that you've done previous on that field. So this is one of those things that you want to check with your local state guidelines, even within the region. Just as an example, in Iowa, for a broadcast application of zinc, we're talking very small amounts. So 5 to 10 pounds of actual zinc per acre. If you're using a product like zinc sulfate, that's only about 30 pounds of actual product that you would be applying on that field. So definitely something you don't want to overapply. Check your soil test before you make those applications on zinc. With that, thank you so much for spending some time with us today talking about sulfur and zinc. We hope you took something from this presentation. As always, reach out with any additional questions to any of us at Wyffels. Thank you so much.